On today's episode of The Millionaire's Lawyer, I am thrilled to be saying I've got Joe Sanok on the show. He's a huge podcaster in his own right. He's got a number of podcasts. He's a TEDx speaker, a business consultant, and has his own very popular podcast, The Practice of the Practice podcast, and has had huge interviews with people like Pat Flynn, John Lee Dumas, Leslie Howes, a whole host of others. He's a rising star in the speaker world. We're thrilled to have him on the show. Joe, how are you doing today?
I'm doing awesome, JP. I'm so excited to be here.
Thanks so much for being on. I was thrilled to be on your show earlier. As I say, I was really impressed with the show, listening to what you have been doing, learning more about that, and I'd like to share some of that with our listeners. Tell us what some of the big differences you've been making that have really taken your business to the next level.
Yeah, I think for me, when I started podcasting, I had no idea how powerful that medium would be. I started planning it in late 2012 and we launched it early 2013. And really at that time, I just had this blog talking about kind of counseling issues in private practice. It's grown to kind of massage therapists, chiropractors, marriage and family therapists. But just talking about what I was learning. So I'd read a book like Guerrilla Marketing and then I'd write a blog post about it and really was a co-learner. And it didn't get a whole lot of traction until I started the podcast. And so when I'm talking to people about growing and amplifying their business, hands down, podcasting, if done correctly, is the easiest way to double and triple your income in a really short period of time. So for me, the podcast has really helped me go from, you know, when I first started it, I was full-time at a community college, making 50 grand a year there, had a small counseling practice on the side. That was growing. I eventually left that job thinking, okay, my counseling practice is really growing. That's going to be what brings in the money. But then, you know, sold that practice earlier this year. And, you know, now I do the podcasting and consulting full time.
So the podcasting consulting has actually taken over, right, from your previous training and from your own practice. You ended up selling the practice. Now you consult back to obviously practitioners and people looking to be involved in the space, right?
Yeah. So I help people start, grow, and scale private practices, but then we also help them launch their big ideas, which is usually through a podcast. A lot of clinicians are sick of kind of sitting in the chair and then doing counseling or, you know, like yourself, if you're just kind of doing the attorney work over and over, but you know, you have these skills that apply to the world well outside of that space, saying, wow, like what would happen if I, as a trauma therapist, could help vets worldwide deal with their trauma through a podcast and really seeing how their income, their innovation, their influence, and their impact all amplify with a podcast.
Yeah, it's the power of the podcast itself. We've talked offline. We've talked previously about some of the connections podcasting has allowed you to make. Tell us about some of those.
Yeah, I think that, you know, podcasting gives you kind of the right to reach out to people you have no business talking to. You know, what would I have reached out to Pat Flynn, who has the Smart Passive Income podcast? And, you know, he's got millions of downloads per episode. The guy's just a rock star. What would I have to say to him? Like, hey, can we get coffee or can I just chat with you for an hour? He'd be like, sure, here's my hourly rate. Or even talking to you on my podcast to talk about business advice. You know, an attorney is going to charge $400, $800 an hour. But to be able to pick these people's brains and build my own sense of skills, when you do that with over 400 episodes, I mean, that's you know, 500 some hours of free consulting that I got. So that alone is helpful. But then there's people that you just kind of connect with on a different level. I think you and I recognize that we're doing something very similar, but in different spaces.
That's right.
And so not knowing where that collaboration will go. I mean, thinking about what are things that are overlap between, you know, million-dollar attorneys and, you know, helping millionaires, you know, and, you know, counseling practitioners and like, who knows what this kind of relationship could lead into. And so being able to follow that curiosity and saying, you know, what would be interesting for me to work on next is an amazing thing to be able to do in your professional career versus that old school way of somebody else kind of blesses you to be partner or blesses you to be able to have a counseling practice. And then you get to get paid a decent wage, but there's no sense of autonomy or, you know, being able to shift if you're sick of something.
Absolutely. It's, as you say, it's a license to explore, isn't it? The traditional models, sure, they work. They can oftentimes be very unfulfilling. They certainly work. They put food on the table, but why not expand, amplify, to use your word again as well, take it to the next level. There's a license to explore and see if you're open to the changes that would welcome into your business to grow your business and help your clients along the way. You've been doing that. Your own business you sold, and now it's evolved into what you're doing now. Tell us a little bit more about what you're doing now.
Yeah. So now we have a number of different kind of products that we offer people that have private practices, from those that are just getting started. So those are cheaper products. We have a membership community that's $99 per month. And that has over 400 people or so in that membership community. So that takes about 2 hours a month of my time to do some live events for them, create e-courses. And then kind of moving up, we have mastermind groups for folks. And then moving up from there, we do one-on-one consulting. And I say we because we have five consultants also that are helping with that work. And then the highest end products is our Done For You podcasting, where we help people that are highly talented. They just want to show up. They want to do an interview or do a solo show. And then they want to be done with the podcast. They recognize the ROI on their time. And so they aren't reaching out and saying, hey, I want to learn how to bootstrap this. They're saying, I want an audio engineer to just quickly go through this, make it sound good, get the show notes, get the transcriptions, have everything optimized, and teach me how I can actually make money off of a podcast. So that's our highest end product that we offer.
Really powerful stuff. As you say, people that recognize the power of the medium and then helping them get there, do that. So what are some of the ways that you coach people or suggest to them they are available to them in order to monetize their own podcast?
Yeah, I think the first thing is just to recognize the opportunity. And that's true, you know, in any business, to look at some of the stats. And so if you look at, I'm big on ROI for my time. So if I'm going to put an hour of my time into something, I want to know that I get a return on investment that's better than if I dinked around on email. And so if I just start with, okay, blogging is a pretty typical advice, you know, for a consulting to build your SEO. So, you know, an hour of my time, if we just looked at the stats of that, you're competing with about 660 million blogs that are out there. That's not blog posts, blogs that are out there. So if that was a 6-foot-tall person, let's compare that just to having a YouTube channel. So the competition with YouTube is around 25 million. And so that's the equivalent difference between those two of a 6-foot-tall person and King Kong, who's 104 feet tall. So it's like, do you want to be King Kong with your ROI or do you want to be a 6-foot-tall person? So the next step up is then saying, what about an inactive podcast? Of all the podcasts that are out there, you know, there's all this great content that some of it's dormant, some of it's pod faded, some of it's, you know, active. The competition there is around 800,000, approaching a million, depending on when you release this, podcasts that are out there. We know that half of the podcasts that start this year will not be around a year from now. And so the difference between that is 7 Titanics stacked on top of each other, bow to stern. And so huge, 7,000 feet tall compared to King Kong, compared to a 6-foot person. So then we look at how many have actually posted a podcast in the last 90 days in competition. We're now talking about around 150,000, depending on, you know, the month you look at. And so we're looking at the competition is now Mount Everest compared to a 6-foot tall person. And so just looking at ROI, if I'm saying, okay, I have an hour of my time, should I do another solo show where I, you know, talk about an in-depth topic, or do I just do a blog post? Hands down, I'm going to spend my time on that podcast because there's just not competition there yet. Excuse me. But then what we see is that there's massive money between Spotify, Apple, you know, Pandora, that they're putting behind that. You know, even Amazon, you can say, hey, Alexa, start the Practice the Practice podcast. And people can just listen to it while they're doing dishes. So there's massive money going into podcasting. And even cars, new cars that are coming out, we're looking at new cars right now.
That's right.
Podcasts, when we were renting a car recently, podcasts were easier to find in the car than the local radio station. And so this is going to be something that, especially as bigger money comes behind it, it's going to be harder and harder to jump in. But we see celebrities jumping in. You know, every time someone's on, you know, Jimmy Fallon, they're saying, oh, I have a new podcast. And we still, though, can specialize in. We're not going to rank against, you know, say Dax Shepard's Armchair Expert or these really big podcasts. But there's really a power in having a super niched in podcast.
Yeah. And so that's what you've done. Obviously, it came from your previous business life and you've niched yourself in there. What are the other podcasts that you're developing and what other niches are you focusing on?
Yeah. And so half of our podcasts, we're focusing in on different aspects of things within the private practice space. So we have one that's around branding a private practice. We have one that's around starting a faith-based practice because that's a big question we get. And so we have a lady that started this massive faith-based practice. And we have another lady who's starting one about how to grow a private practice, a group private practice, so adding clinicians. And then we have another one that's all about systems to scale. And so what are the systems private practices need? So we recognized that our consultants had room to grow. They had more products they could offer, but we wanted to really give them kind of the space to launch those podcasts to talk about those. So in the other four that we have that we're launching with our Done For You folks, is we have the Imperfect Thriving podcast. So it's this amazing woman, Catherine, who's from Alabama. She wants to stand up against kind of the patriarchy and say that women can be more than just a mom and a wife, that they can do all sorts of things. And it's this Imperfect Thriving. There's another lady, Melissa, who's out in San Diego. She's a fitness instructor, but she takes a very different approach than just like lose weight or eat fewer carbs. She really sees it as a whole mindset as well. So she has the Bomb Mom podcast.
I love that.
Yeah, and my wife actually joined her program and just, I was blown away at just the system she had. So when she became one of our clients, I was just amazed. We also have Veronica, who has the Empowered and Unapologetic podcast. So that podcast is for women that have been stay-at-home moms that have kind of lost themselves in being a mom. And so they are a mom, a wife, but they're like, who am I? So very similar to kind of the Imperfect Thriving podcast, but from a little different perspective and a little different age demographic. And then the last one is the Beta Male Revolution podcast. So Billy and Brandy are a couple. And they're talking about instead of alpha males that are this kind of macho, I'm going to work out, I don't have any sense of feelings. They're talking about the beta males, the guys that are more sensitive, more grounded, that, you know, maybe have trouble standing up for themselves, but, you know, have a lot to say. And so there are a couple where Billy considers himself a beta male. And so they're talking about that and they're exploring that and interviewing people. And so it's great because there's these podcasts that genuinely are kind of disrupting the market. And they're saying, we're therapists, we're counselors, we're people who have really helped the world in individual sessions. Now we're going to take that out to this greater world. So we started the Practice Podcast Network so that we can start to support these kind of life-changing podcasts in a different way where we all can support each other rather than just kind of starting on our own.
Oh, that's great stuff, Joe. I mean, well, if you want to give us the details for all those podcasts you just mentioned, we'll put them in the show notes. Great plugs for all the different podcasts and the folks that you're working with as well. A great range of topics or ways of coming at the different topics. And as you say, a niche, right? Niche developing and growing the space for there. So obviously you and I are both sold. We're convinced of the power of podcasts, ways to grow a business and a presence. And I think we've just did a nice job of focusing on some of the reasons why there. As you work with people that are in private practice, obviously a podcast is an important part of what your teachings are, but what are some of the other things that you would coach someone in private practice or someone with, as is the case with the Millionaire's Lawyer, perhaps in private business, that's looking to grow their business in addition to podcasts? What are some of the other things that you would coach people or suggest they do to grow their business?
Yeah. So first we kind of looked at what's the problem, what's the opportunity, how do we move on from there? So the very first thing you want to ask yourself is what's the purpose of this podcast? So someone like you may say, I want to grow my referrals, you know, as an attorney. So it's more local based. So say you only had one location. You may just say, okay, my one location, I'm going to focus on this area versus I want to start offering coaching or masterminds or a membership community that can be nationwide. And so if you're going to do something that's a little bit more localized, you don't want a podcast that covers national issues. You want ones that are specific. So I'm in Traverse City, Michigan. So say my counseling practice, I still owned that. I hadn't sold it. If I wanted to just boost that, I might look at my focus with that counseling practice and say, well, how do I go a little bit more general than that? Now, I would also then challenge myself to look at the numbers of how many podcast listeners are probably in Northern Michigan. Will a percentage of those then come work with me? And is it worth my time? Usually what I recommend is that people go national. So find something that is national that you can teach that everybody, you know, that's within your specialty would want to follow. So once we decide that, the biggest thing we want to say is, as a result of this podcast, what is the pain that people come with and what's the transformation that we want them to experience as they listen to podcasts? So for example, Bomb Mom podcast. You know, she has these women who have always wanted to work out more. They haven't been motivated. They feel like maybe their bodies were different in their 20s and now they've had kids. But they're ready. They want to become a bomb mom. They're not challenging as many of the mindsets, but they're saying, I want to go after it, but I want some guidance here. And so the transformation is that you're going to feel confident for yourself, not just for your husband and not just for your kids or your friends, but you're going to build this confidence. And so we start with that. And then we build out an email course. Now, a lot of people, what they'll do is they'll build a whole e-course or a membership community. They'll put tons of time into it and then nobody buys it. And then they're cramming their audience into it. So what we've figured out is what really ensures success in monetizing a podcast. So first and foremost, we do an email course because email still is the best way for you to own your message to your audience. So Now, even recently, the Yahoo groups, they decided they're shutting those down. So the people that in the 90s and 2000s really invested in Yahoo groups, all their content is going to disappear unless they talk to, you know, Yahoo and Verizon to get that content back. An email series, you then own that content. You own that list. You can download those people and switch to a different platform. So we start there, and there's a three-part framework that we teach. So first and foremost, we do three emails all around the problem. So we're sketching it out. And so why are you set up for failure in society? Why are you basically, it's a lose-lose situation. So for counselors in private practice, what that looks like is grad school never teaches you business. Like, you are set up to fail in business, and it's not your fault. So you're normalizing those feelings of, I don't know what I'm doing in business. Well, yeah, of course you don't. You didn't get taught that. And so we have three emails that kind of look at societal things that have set you up for failure. But we're also giving hope in that, saying we don't have to stay there. Yeah, you can feel bad for yourself, but let's actually push back on that and say what's next. So then the next three emails in the second part is all around quick wins. So here's a quick win that I want you to experience. So take some quick actions this week to take a small step. You want to see it as almost like a date where, okay, you know, I met this person, we have kind of some casual conversations. Now we're going a little bit deeper. If they then buy into that, what's the next natural step? We don't want to give them too much content at once, because if we overwhelm them, they're going to unsubscribe. So those next three emails are all around quick wins.
What are some of the quick wins? Give us examples of quick wins.
Yeah, so for example, a quick win for a business might be, if you say you're a lawn care business and you're in Sarasota, just go Google Sarasota lawn care, and I want you to look at the top five Google maps. How many reviews do they have? Do they have one review? Do they have 20 reviews? That right there is going to tell you how much your competition is really focusing on, say, reviews in your area. And so if most of them only have one or two reviews, that means if you get 10 reviews, most likely you're going to get a lot more clients. And so those kind of, it's going to take them 5 minutes to do it, but it gives a huge return on investment for that time. Because if you know, I need to focus on Google reviews now, and that's going to really help me, that then shows them, you know what you're talking about, and you can teach them quickly these shortcuts. So then the third part is going to be all around long-term habits. And so we know business is a long game. And so we've now deconstructed how things feel in the world. We say, you're set up for failure. Here's some quick wins. So they're building that trust. Now, what are three habits that if they did that over the next 2 or 3 months, every single day or every single week, that they would have a massive step forward in their business, in their life goals, whatever the thing is that you're teaching in your podcast. So then after we've written these nine emails, we then go back and say, what would be an email opt-in we could design using something like Canva, which is a free platform, that would enhance this nine-part email series. We do that at the end, even though it's the first email, because we want something like a workbook or an infographic or, you know, something they can cut out and put on their mirror, whatever it is that matches your email sequence, that's going to really help them get even more out of it. So what's great about having that is then when you're on somebody else's podcast, before you even launch your podcast, you can say, hey, you know, head on over to practicethepractice.com/podcast guide. You can get my 27 tips, tricks, and stats that are all about podcasting if you're into this. Also, I have a whole guide for you all on podcasting. And so then you're building your audience before you've even launched anything.
Yeah, and you're creating value. I guess that's part of what is very important with this as well. You're giving something to people that might be listening. Obviously, they're interested if they're consuming already. And then they're saying, I can learn something from this guy. They are receiving something of value. And I guess in the course of that, you're also establishing your expertise.
Yeah, and you think about what emails you subscribe to and hate. Usually it's, you know, sign up for our email, get 25% off. You're like, okay, yeah, I want to get 25% off. But then I unsubscribe the next day, or I get a couple more deals and I'm like, oh, just unsubscribe. Or you get stuck on those emails. It's ones that don't provide value. But if someone can match where I want to go, like say somebody said, hey, I'm going to walk you through how to start your podcast, things to think about before you even invest a dollar into podcasting. If I had had that when I launched my podcast, that would have been a game changer for me. I would have opened every single one of those emails because it offered tremendous value to me.
Yeah. There's the learning from that. Yeah. So, I mean, that's back as you originally created it. How have you grown your base so much? I mean, obviously by doing it on a regular basis, as you're describing, but what else are you doing to grow your base?
Yeah, I think one of the bigger things, I'd say there's three main things that really help. I think connecting with influencers that aren't quite the big time influencers. It's nice to have those big names, but honestly, they're not going to email their list and say, hey, I was just on Joe's podcast. It's the people that are maybe a little bit kind of below where I'm at that are just like, you know what? It's amazing. I was just on Joe's podcast. I'm going to email the 500 people on my email list. Those are the ones that are going to kind of brag about being on the podcast. I think that has grown my base significantly. I think also working with people that are up and coming and having them come into my mastermind groups, because then when they experience success, when they've tripled their income in a year, they say it's all because of Joe Sanok. Like it's he guided me through this. It's amazing. He helped me kind of restructure things. Even the event we put on called Killing It Camp, most of the speakers were people who had been in my mastermind groups or had been in my membership community. And that was because I knew their content was going to be solid. I knew that they kind of did it the same way. There wasn't going to be anything that went against what I was teaching. But the unintended consequence was that they all said, man, you got to join Joe's mastermind group. You got to join his membership community. That's the game changer for me. And so I think that was one thing that I just accidentally did. And the third thing I would say is to just really look at what works. I don't remember who I heard say it, but they said, when you discover a unicorn, make mini unicorns. And so, for example, I had a blog post I wrote called How to Name a Counseling Practice. It accidentally ranked number one in Google whenever anyone would search for that. I was in my analytics and it was like my homepage, my about me page. And then all of a sudden this random blog post, I'm like, why is that number three? And so I looked at it and dug in a little bit and just realized I'm ranking number one for how to name a practice. So what did I do? I wrote three more articles about it. I did a series on it. I did a podcast about it. We now have an e-course about it. You know, people want to know how to name a practice. And what's the next step after they decide on a name? Probably filing their LLC unless they're in California. Mm-hmm. So then we have an affiliate link for Swift filing. And then what's the next step after that? Well, they probably want to figure out where to rent. And so then we have a podcast about that. And so kind of naturally taking them down that journey. And we have a 28-step checklist that walks them through that. That's our opt-in. So what is it on our how to name a counseling practice site that pops up? Do you want a 28-step checklist to figure out how to start a practice? Well, yeah, that would keep me way more organized. That sounds awesome. So then by doing these things and saying, what's the natural next step for my listener? For me, what it does is it offers genuine value, but it's really not the information that gets people in. It's the speed. Like, I think that's where they're willing to then pay for services because they say, I know it's all on your website, but honestly, I just want to spend like 15 minutes with you. You tell me what to do. And then we'll jump on a phone call in 2 weeks and have another phone call. They want that speed and that focus. And so giving away content like crazy, that is a great strategy. Like, don't hold back on that because people pay for the shortcuts.
Yeah, so they're interested in getting that shortcut, which is great. Again, establishes that credibility. And then for those that are really interested, they realize the value in the do-it-for-you service, aren't they? They're looking at that and saying, wow, you know what you're doing here. I'm very good at something else. I'm going to pay you to actually do what you're good at to help me get my message out for what I'm good at. And that's really important. That's the power of leverage.
Absolutely. You know, every time that we've launched a product for the last three launches, we've sold out. And we did this system where we figured out once for any podcast, once you have at least 1,000 listens and 100 people, 1,000 listens per episode and 100 people on your email list, that's when you want to launch your first product. Because if you just look at the stats, about 10% of your listeners will opt into your email, to your email course. And then of that, about 5 to 10% are going to buy your first product. So having 5 to 10 customers is going to be a good first start for a higher end product. So once you have 100 people on that email list, you're going to email them and just say, I would love to jump on a 15-minute phone call with you to ask you three questions. And you can decide whether or not you're going to tell those three questions ahead of time or not. It doesn't really matter. But the three questions you're going to ask during this phone call are, first, what's it been like experiencing whatever the pain is that you work on? So for me, it's what's it been like starting a counseling practice? Tell me about this. You're hearing how they describe their pain. You know, for Melissa with the Bomb Mom podcast, she might say, you know, what's it been like to try to get fit and to become a bomb mom? How do you describe being a bomb mom and how's that been hard for you? So you're getting in your client's words what it is that, you know, life is like. Second question is, if there was a magical product that you could design that absolutely met most of those needs, what would it look like? So when we launched Next Level Practice, which is our membership community, we were thinking we were going to be around $30 a month. Then people said, you know what, if we could have a community that was more than a Facebook group, like, you know, live groups that people worked in, if we had accountability partners, if we got a free logo, if we had, you know, e-courses every single month, live events. So people were listing these things and it was like, wow, if we're going to do this, we can't charge $30 a month. Like, we need to have a higher amount than that. And then when I got to the third question, which is how much would you pay for this magical product? You know, we had a handful of people that said, you know, $5 a month. There's some people said, oh, I'd pay $300 a month. But most people said if it was under $100 a month, I'd absolutely buy into that. So now I've got my first 20 people or so that I've interviewed and said, hey, you know, like I heard you. Here's the summary of what I heard from this. We're going to launch a beta test group for Next Level Practice, which is our membership community. What we heard from you is that you want regular kind of tools of the trade, like logos. You want a community that goes deeper than a Facebook group. You want ongoing content like e-courses and live events and access to me. So we're going to offer all of that, but we don't know if our webinar platform is going to work. We don't know like if we're going to screw things up. So instead
it's
of the
beta, you're saying it's a beta, right? Yeah.
Instead of the $88 a month, we're going to start at $55 a month, but we're going to lock you in at that. Like you'll never have your prices raised. So then that first 50 people that joined, they said, holy cow, like this is awesome. So what's nice about this is before I ever put any effort into building it, I have money in hand. I have customers that have actually paid for it versus I'm going to spend months building an e-course only to try to kind of ram people into my e-course that they don't want to buy.
Yeah. So you're doing it. A lot of people sell, you know, make the course, get the course and then sell the course, where you're doing it the opposite way. Let's create the community first, the community of paying clients, and then develop it to their actual wishes or what they're actually asking for. And I think it's probably because it's focused, going back to what we said before, because it's the niche, right? Because you've catered to the niche. And so you're hearing from the members of that niche what they're specifically looking for. That's actually a really important lesson for those listening.
Yeah. And I think at each phase, we had indicators of whether we were going to move into the next phase. So I emailed my list and said, here's what happened. You know, I met with these 20 people. Here's a summary of it. If you want early opt-in, I want you to just opt into the separate email list and you'll get the very first emails to opt in. We're setting, you know, January 1st, I think it was 2017. I think it was January 5th, 2017, the first Monday, whatever the first Monday was in that January. And that's when we're going to release it. But we did this email back in November. So if I had one person or 10 people opt into that, that would have been like, whoa, like maybe I shouldn't put a whole lot of time.
Yeah.
But we had 200 people opt in for the 50 spots that we had. So that really tells me, okay, people are interested. I told them the price. They are ready to go. And now they have a date. That then makes me say, okay, now I'm going to do a release. And so if we had sold only 5 spots or 10 spots, I would have just said, I'm going to refund your money. We got to reset. I don't know what happened here with that beta group. But, you know, we had 50 people opt in at the $55. Okay, now we've got some money coming in every single month that we can decide how we're going to spend this to keep kind of building it out.
So, yeah, it's great that you're reverse engineering where you want to be. And then I guess there's a confirmation of concept prior to building it. It'd be great I mean, that's a lesson for any business owner. It'd be great if there's a way to design that for anybody's business to think that they could actually have the luxury of doing that. Obviously, you've done that thoughtfully to allow that to occur, and you've built it that way. That wants me to shift gears a little bit to some of the things that I know you've spoken and written on previously, Joe. And that is how you get to those types of thoughts. I know you've talked in the past about slowing down to spark innovation, right? It's one of your one of the topics that you've discussed as you apply it, obviously, the way you apply it to your business and help others grow their businesses. What do you mean when you say that?
Yeah, JP, that's such an important question because, you know, that's what my TEDx talk was about. If we just reflect on when do you have the best ideas? You know, when are you feeling like, okay, this is the big step forward? Those realizations, it's usually in the shower, it's on a long drive when you turn off the radio or podcasts, it's on a hike or something like that. You know, our brains naturally, when they slow down, kind of start to get more creative. When we're stressed out, we go with what we know. And so like when this really kind of came to mind was I was in Nepal hiking with a friend there. We were down in the Chitwan jungle after being in the Himalayas. And we're on this kind of canoe with a guide, and there's this Peace Corps volunteer, and she's there kind of on break. And this guy, he had flown across the globe to declare his love for this woman in front of us. And only to get shot down in front of us.
Oh gosh, that's another podcast.
So it was awkwardly at the edge of this jungle. So our guide says to us, you know, if we get chased by a rhinoceros, climb a tree. Which, I mean, I really should have asked a couple follow-up questions. Like, you know, what kind of tree? Like, how often does this happen? You know, just, can we practice a little bit?
Yeah, really.
But I didn't. So we go into the jungle. It feels just like a regular kind of hike. You know, there's some small monkeys and birds I haven't seen, but nothing kind of big like a rhino. So then we come across a rhino maybe 20 yards away. And this was in the early 2000s. I had a like kind of one of those point and click cameras. It wasn't a digital camera. So I take a picture, kind of like move it forward like this. And then I'm like, I have no idea if this is going to be blurry. So I take a step forward, take another picture. I'm like, I got to take another step forward. So I take another step forward and this rhino charges. Wow. And I just take off running because I know that like in college or in high school track with my friend Todd, I had been a sprinter and I had at least 100 yards on him, but he was like a long distance runner. So I'm like in the front, he's right behind me. The Peace Corps volunteer and this guy are behind them. So I'm just like take off running. So we come back after we don't hear the rhino and our guide is up in a tree, like he had said, and he kind of shimmies down and says, why, you know, run up tree. And it, to me, that just represents how when you're in stress, like I'm going to outrun Todd. I'm not going to try something new where I'm going to climb a tree. And so, you know, we look at, you know, so Timothy Ferris wrote Tribe of Mentors, and he found that one of the most common things among top CEOs is a daily meditation that they do as a way to ground themselves. You know, Winston Churchill, he had his afternoon non-negotiable nap. Steve Jobs, some of the most important meetings he would have would be a walking meeting because, you know, it paces out your breathing and it has lower blood pressure. And so it's like there's this secret among these top performers of just like allowing your brain to rest. And, you know, at Slowdown School, which is an event we host in the summertime on the beaches of Northern Michigan, people fly in on Sunday. We pick them up in a big yellow school bus, drive them out to where we stay on this beautiful campus right on the water. We have an executive chef. And we encourage them for the next 2 days to turn off their phone except for pictures, to just enjoy hiking. We bring out a massage therapist and a yoga teacher. We have campfires. We hang out on the beach and skip stones. And the first day is usually rough for all of us, where we're just so used to just the speed of looking at the news and looking at our business. But by day two, it's like they all wake up with this glow on their face. And then day three on Wednesday, we start working on their businesses. And those things that they came in with that they thought were going to be the important thing they worked on almost always take the back seat to something that's even bigger that they hadn't realized. And so like in the 20-minute sprints we do around their businesses, one guy sketched out 7 chapters of a book in 20 minutes.
Wow.
Another lady named her consulting business, bought the URL, and had outlined her entire email course in 20 minutes. And so when we do this, when we slow down and genuinely let our brains rest, we get to kind of that core of our brain that helps us kind of unlock things in a new way.
Yeah, so it's very key to be, first of all, aware that that exists, and then give yourself an opportunity to get there, right? And then obviously capture what has come or been inspired by allowing yourself to be in that moment. What are some of the things that allow us to really take advantage once we're in that kind of flow?
Yeah, I think once we're in that flow is really understanding your priorities. For most people, you know, they'll wake up, they'll look at their text messages, they'll look at their email. Those are all external of you. That's other people's priorities, other people's agendas. If you can wake up and say, my big thing for today is to sketch out what my podcast would look like, to take a big step forward by writing out an email course, to really define what your day looks like, that's really important. I think in regards to the setup also, automating your morning as much as possible. So I get my clothes out the night before. The first real choice that I have to make for the morning is when I drop off my girls and I'm getting back in the car. Do I want to listen to a podcast on the drive home or do I want there to be silence? That's my first real choice because I know what I'm going to have for breakfast. I know what I'm going to wear. And so all of that allows me when it's time to start to fully jump in with all of my energy. And so like this morning, for example, the only choice I had to make was whether to listen to the news or podcast in the car. And now I'm here with you. And so I come fully prepared because my brain is ready to go. It's like ready to talk business. Whereas if I had checked email or been like frustrated with the text that I got or, you know, did all these other things, it then makes it that maybe I'm going to have less of my game on when I'm on JP's show.
There you go. Yeah. Cause I guess that was going to lead me to my next question is what are some of the blockers, right? And again, it's being aware. So as you say, checking the emails or understanding that there are other outside distractions and things that will bring other people's agendas into your world. What are some of the other sort of things that really prevent us from being there?
Yeah, I think that we all feel like there's always too much to do in our business. And so to take any extra time we just say, like, I don't have time to take that extra time. And so we let a lot of that creep in. So if we say, I'm going to take this Friday off to just rejuvenate, it's like, well, I'll do a little email. And then, you know, somebody texts me and, oh, there's this fire.
And the day is a good, the day's over, right?
The day's over. Yeah. And so I think there are fires you have to put out. But we want to examine, why did that fire happen? And so we want to work upstream and say, can I outsource this? Rory Vaden, he has this thing called the focus funnel. It's from Procrastinate on Purpose. And so he has this great way of looking at, first of all, could this task, could it be deleted? Like, could we just totally eliminate it? Second, could it be automated? Then next, could it be delegated? And then if it comes all the way to the bottom of the funnel to me, is this a priority right now? And if not, then I'm going to procrastinate on purpose and put it back to the top of the funnel. And so that idea of saying, well, what else could I give to an assistant? You know, my assistant, you know, she's paid $14 an hour. I have another assistant that's paid $17 an hour. I remember there was a flaw with Zapier in the integration between Teachable and our email sequencing, where when somebody bought in Teachable, it wasn't adding them to our email list for some reason. And I had spent like 10 minutes on it, and I just was so frustrated. It was draining my energy. Finally, I said to my assistants, I know you don't want to do this, but I don't want to figure out Zapier. Like, this is just pissing me off so much. Can you do it? And so it took them 2 or 3 hours to sort it all out, but that's $50 well spent to preserve that energy for my clients, for making new sales, for coming up with new ideas for content. So most people, I think, we'll say, well, why would I pay somebody to check my email? So I have somebody check my email. She goes through the 200 emails we get a day and stars the ones that only I can reply to. Like you were saying, oh yeah, I got, you know, all of your content and, you know, all, I didn't send you that. That was Jess that got it all to you. And if there was anything that happened that she didn't know how to solve, she'd, you know, text me, hey, I have a quick question for JP. Cause I would know that. But being able to take as much off your plate as possible is really smart.
Yeah, and allow you to focus on the things that are priority. So how do you establish the things that are priority then?
Yeah, and so for me, I think, when is my energy best? And so I realized recently, I have a bad back. I had surgery when I was 20 years old, had herniated discs. So all of these flare-ups of back problems. And so for me, health, I've realized I need to most like every day, I need to be doing something active and probably something aerobic most days of the week. So then looking forward with that priority, I started blocking out 8 a.m. to 9:30 every single day. It's on repeat. It blocks out. My ideal morning now is if I go to the YMCA, come home, sit in the hot tub, take a shower, 9:30, I'm ready for the day. For most people, that's like pure luxury. And so saying, what is the life blocking that I'm going to do here? And so it was 3 years ago or so that I started taking Fridays off. And so I did that as an experiment in the summertime to just see. Magically, I got more done in 4 days than I did in 5. So we kept that experiment going. The next summer, I said, I kind of hate Mondays. What if I took Mondays off too? Did that as an experiment, kept that going. And so being able to block out when you do things, what that does is it forces you to drop the ball. And then to say, why am I doing this? I didn't get to all these to-do list items. Is it really essential for me to do these things? And then what happens is to be able to say, to your question of how do you focus, I would say having one reality goal and having one risk goal. So your reality goal is getting things that you have going more automated or streamlined than before. So for example, if I'm running a mastermind group, say I'm pulling that recording and dropping it into a Facebook group, I should say to my assistant, okay, 24 hours after the mastermind, please log into my Facebook, drop it into the group, and put that there. It takes me 5 minutes, but that's 5 minutes that I could forget about or whatever. So that's just kind of automating the reality. Then looking at the risk goal, that's going to be something that's bigger. So at the end of last year, I said to myself, okay, in 2020, I want to be able to at least be on track for writing a New York Times bestseller. That was my big risk goal. I could waste a bunch of time on it. We'll see what happens. So first step for that was to find an agent. So every single podcast guest that had a traditionally published book, I said to him, you know, I'm shopping around for a new agent. Would you mind introducing me to your agent? They all introduced me, and within about a week, I had 5 agents that wanted to talk to me. Now, I didn't even have an agent, so shopping around for a new agent meant getting a new agent, but you know, it's all how you frame it.
It's all positioning, that's right.
Yeah. So then I met Greg, my agent, down in Austin, and you know, we were a great fit, and he connected me with my book coach, and you know, she's awesome at writing. She's helped with tons of New York Times bestsellers. So that door has kind of been opened and unlocked for me. And now it's just a matter of each week, you know, I've blocked out from 10 a.m. to noon every Thursday. Nancy and I have a conversation to get that book proposal together. So then I don't have to worry about what it's going to look like later on to market a book or to write a book. The task at hand is getting this book proposal done, doing the best job we can, and then I can worry about those other things when we get there.
Yeah, you do. I can tell a lot of these things very intentionally, right? You're very interestingly, you reverse engineer. You want that book. How do I get to that spot where that book is? And I'd like to take a second to talk about that because we've talked offline. Obviously, the book's very exciting. Tell us a little bit more about what you're writing on now, what the focus is, and what the listeners can expect to see.
Yeah. So right now, so I'm not really allowed to talk about too much of it yet, especially because it's going to publishers. But it's a lot of these themes of how do you optimize your life? How do you slow down to spark innovation? How do you work less to make more money, but also not just to make money? Like, I'm not interested in just helping people buy, you know, a fancy car. To me, it's all about how are we bettering the world through our work, but also not just killing ourselves to do it. And so we're going to dive into a lot of those issues, kind of challenging a lot of the Protestant work ethic and looking at where that came from and why it really was beneficial for very rich people to have people want to just work harder and not get paid for it. And so going to dive into a lot of that.
Yeah. So you're going to have to tell us how to get a hold of that when it's time as well. And just generally speaking, maybe Joe, give us a chance to understand. We talked earlier about a number of the things that you are working on and some of the people that you're working with, but what are the best ways to reach out and find you?
Yeah, I would say the best ways, if you're interested in podcasting, we do have an e-course that's coming out early next year. It's called Podcast Launch School. And so that's for somebody that more wants to do it themselves. They want to learn the back end. It's going to be around $1,000. And so it's going to save you, you know, hundreds of hours of just frustration to just have all that information in one spot. So podcastlaunchschool.com, you can get first access to that when that releases. If somebody wants to talk with me about potentially doing the Done For You podcasting, we are starting a new cohort in early 2020. And so they can apply over at practiceofthepractice.com/apply. And then our podcast is all over the place wherever you listen to podcasts. You can always email me through the website. We have live chat with my assistant, Jess. So when in doubt, just go to practiceofthepractice.com and then you'll see the live chat and you can ask Jess anything she wants. And if it needs to kind of go on to me, then it will.
It will go on to. And for anybody listening as well, there's a wealth of resources there on the Practice of the Practice as well. So as Joe mentions that, please do go and have a look at that. As I say, there's all kinds of information that might be relevant to certainly a practice. But I also think general business principles as well, Joe, as I look through the materials, like there's a lot of things that are very, very valuable for business owners in general there.
Absolutely. And I think that, you know, it's only going to be more and more that podcasting leads the way for those businesses that really want to thrive.
That's just the case, right? So we've established the power of the medium. Joe, I appreciate all the other advice and tips really that you've offered for listeners, for business owners. I'd like to leave these podcasts with sort of one thing for a listener to take through the rest of their day or week. So, I mean, you offer a lot of real great general advice and ways of focusing in to make sure people are slowing down, sparking innovation, being good in their own right. What is one thing you would leave them with today as they listen to the end of this podcast that may influence their day, maybe influence others around them, and perhaps even the rest of their week in a very positive way?
Yeah, I would say, you know, with highly educated people like your audience, the tendency is to do it right the first time. You know, we go through school and we write a paper over and over, we go to the writing center, we finally turn it in to get that grade. That just doesn't work in the business world as well. And so I want to encourage people to not be paralyzed by perfection, but to get things done. We have a saying within Practice the Practice, and that's proceed until apprehended. I want my staff to move forward quickly and to innovate. And if they do something that I don't like, they aren't going to get in trouble for it. I would rather they move quickly with creative ideas than to ask for my permission. And so that idea of proceed until apprehended goes a long way. And so whether it's you or your team, that idea of not being paralyzed by perfection, that's going to release creativity that you had no idea was within your team or within yourself.
There you go. That's really proceed until apprehended. Interesting to be saying that to a lawyer, I have to say, because normally we'd be advising people not to do that and certainly make sure that we're on speed dial if they do. So great to hear you applying that to a business setting. Joe, thanks so much for being on the show today. A wealth of knowledge, as they say, on the website itself and obviously from Joe himself. Feel free to reach out to him. We'll have everything you mentioned on the show notes, Joe. And of course, anybody listening, feel free to have a listen. to Joe's podcast as well, any of the people that he supports. Thanks so much for being on the show today, Joe. I look forward to seeing you next time.
Thanks so much, JP.